Okay, so those who worship God in person and online will be in the speech control, children and adults together, or worshipers, God be with them. Today, the title of my message is, What is our hope, our joy when it comes? There are four verses. I can go into these verses. Key verse is verse 19. Let's read key verse together, please. What is our hope, our joy, or the crown in which we can glory in the presence of our Lord Jesus when He comes? Is it not new? Yes. The crown in which we will glory in the presence of our Lord Jesus when He comes. In the last lesson, chapter 2, verse 1 through 16, we thought of Paul's life as a gospel servant or a shepherd. He made an appeal against false accusations that he was just like all other false prophets. He had to appeal to protect the church of God's flagship. In that we could see the quality of gospel servants. First of all, having pure motives. Can repent of impure motives at each time, keep pure motives, and striving to please God, and having God as a witness. And positively, he testifies to his shepherd life. His life as a father or mother-like shepherd. Mother is like a nursing mother, gently and tenderly caring for their children and showing sacrificial service. And also father's exulting and disciplining love. We really pray that we may grow also to be mother-like, shepherd-like, or father-like shepherds. Missionary Moses prayed. In today's passage, he makes an appeal for another occasion that Paul's not returning to Thessalonica showed his no concern for the people there. He has to make an appeal. And in this appeal in the defense, you can see that Paul's deep affection for them. And also Paul showed his joy and glory at the coming of the Lord Jesus. And Paul's outstanding affectionate heart is none other than reflection of God's loving heart for his people. And his expectation of the Lord's coming with joy and glory indicates what truly matters in life. First, out of sight, not out of mind. Now Paul says in verse 17, But brothers, when you are torn away from you for a short time, in person, not in thought, out of intense longing, we made every effort to see you. As you studied, Paul's leaving Thessalonica was forceful and abrupt. He was driven out of the city against his will. He had to be separated with the Thessalonians against their will, contrary to their wishes. He had to be separated. Paul felt that, expressed this way, when you are torn away from you, implying his heart being torn apart. He was like parents who have been torn apart from their beloved children because of some reasons. Paul wanted the Thessalonians to know that his heart in this situation was not okay with such a separation. And then he says, after saying, you're torn away from you. He said, for a short time. He makes sure that in such situation, it would be a short time in his mind. He wanted to know that it is not, would not be a long, infinitely long time in the disguise of no return. No. In such a short time, would not bear it to him. He could not bear it, even such a short time of separation. And then, in person, not in thought. They are saying, out of sight, out of mind. But never in the case of Paul. Even in such a separation, they were in Paul's heart and thought. Amid unwanted separation, they were in Paul's heart and thought, as you remembered, thought of in chapter 1. He remembered before God all what they did, their work of faith, labor of love, and endurance hope, remembered in his thought. And then, out of intense longing, there was intense longing in Paul's heart to see them again. It was not an ordinary desire, but great intense desire, great desire, eager desire, in other translations. All the more eager with a great desire, longing desire. And that longing desire and thought and eagerness made Paul and his companions to endeavor, strive hard, make every effort to accomplish what they wished. Then subsequently Paul says, "For we wanted to come to you." So I, Paul, did again and again. And here we see more and more Paul's heart for them. The sentence, "We want to come to you," seems to be redundant, but he expressed it. There are three more emphases in this phrase. Certainly, I, Paul, is stressing his personal longing on top of team's longing. I, Paul, did again and again. And then he says, our hope, our joy, crown, our glory, and joy again. In this way, Paul expressed his longing and eagerness and love and heart for them with more than 10 emphases. His heart being torn away, short time, in person, not in thought, longing desire, making every effort, you know, to come to see you. I, Paul, again and again. And then our hope, our joy, crown, again our glory and joy. What an expression. This Paul's longing, heart, and love for them is none other than reflection of God's heart and love for his people in Jesus Christ. From time to time, God's people feel that they have been torn apart from God because of their adverse situations and human conditions, and cannot be sure of God's love anymore. But we have to know that God's love is unchanging. What changes is our attitude toward the love of God, unchanging love of God, because of adversities and afflictions. Hebrews 13:8 says, Jesus Christ the same, yesterday, today, and forever. God wants us to be assured of his love, unchanging love, in any changing life situation. The last week in the lesson, we thought about nursing mother, mother's gentle, tender caring for her little ones, taking the child in his bosom, arms, which is the most tender, gentle, and cherishing relationship in all human life. But God says in Isaiah chapter 49, verse 15, "Can a mother forget the baby at her breast? Have no compassion for the child she has born. Though she may forget, I will not forget you. See, I engraved you on the palms of my hands." Can the mother Hannah, is possible for mother Hannah forget Jonathan? Mother Jamie forget Abby Mother Sarah Grace forget joy? Is it possible? Though they may forget, I will not forget you. Even all the world forgets you, I will not forget you. That's what God says. And then Zephaniah 3:17 says, the Lord your God is with you. He's mighty to save. He'll take great delight in you. He'll quiet you with his love and rejoicing over you with singing. Who can take great delight in me? Who can rejoice over me with singing? But God does. Yes, these promises are given to the Israelites, but this is fulfilled in Jesus Christ, who is redeemed people. Isn't it true? God demonstrates his love more than this. What Paul says is in Romans chapter 5. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous man, though for a good man someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we are still sinners, Christ died for us. Who could die for ungodly, selfish, self-centered, wicked sinners like you and me? Who could die? I know, nobody liked me, timid and fearless person. But Christ, the greatest one, the most righteous one, the best one, died for you and me. What can be a greater demonstration of his love than this? Can you find a greater demonstration of his love than this? He demonstrated and demonstrates every day, present form, how much I love you. His love for you and for me, demonstration. When Jesus talked about his leaving to his disciples, they felt that they were like orphans. But Jesus said, I will not leave you like orphans, I'll come to you. This is the promise of Jesus coming again. And then the risen Jesus, before his ascension, said, surely I am with you always to the very end of the age. Surely. And he is sitting at the right hand of God. What is he doing? He's interceding for his people. He lives forever, interceding for his people, thinking of his own, whom he purchased with his blood, interceding for us. This is also in accordance with what we sang, hymn song moment by moment. Never a trial that he is not there. Never a burden that he does not bear. Never a sorrow that he does not share. Moment by moment, I'm under his care. Let's sing this part together, please. Never a trial that he is not there. Never a burden that he does not bear. Never a sorrow that he does not share. Moment by moment, I'm under his love. Next verse 2. Never a heartache and never a groan. Never a teardrop and never a moan. Never a danger but there on the throne. Moment by moment he thinks of his own. Moment by moment I'm kept in his love. Moment by moment I've life from above. Looking to Jesus till glory does shine. Moment by moment, oh Lord, I am thine. Yes, he thinks of his own, purchased by his blood, interceding for us. In that, Paul declares, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine? Nakedness or dangerous sword? No, in all these things we are more than conquerors. We are convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels or demons, neither the future or the present, nor any powers, nor height or depth or anything else, we are able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. So this love of God is true. So what do you have to do is we should hold fast to this love. We should not let us to be drifted away straight by situation. Let our feelings go. No, we hold fast to this love. Hold fast. And according to Ephesians, put the full armor of God. First thing is stand firm with a belt of truth around your waist. What is truth? Great truth is God's love. Buckle the belt of truth around your waist. Tighten it. Have strength. You can be assured with love. And we do not live by sight, but by faith, as you sang. We really hold fast this truth of God's love, dwell in it. Praise and thank God for His love. Experience victories of life one by one. Amen. Second, Satan's hindrance. Now Paul says, but Satan stopped us. Paul clearly says, Satan blocked their way. Satan did not want their meeting together, Paul and Thessalonians. Satan did not want. Satan stopped them. On an occasion, when Paul and his team went to go to Asia to preach the gospel, Holy Spirit would not allow them to. So, Paul could distinguish from the work of Satan and the work of the Holy Spirit. This time, sure, Satan stopped us. Satan stopped us. Satan hindered and thwarted their plan, blocking the way. We don't know how, but he said, probably changing the schedule of sailing, or Paul or one of his companions becoming sick or get injuries. We don't know, but anyway, clear to Paul that Satan stopped us. It's very important to know, to discern between the two, Holy Spirit's blocking and Satan's blocking. If you are sure that it's the Holy Spirit does not allow us to do certain things, then we should not do that. Never. We turned away from my own way. But if we are sure that, certain that, Satan stops us, then we should not be disappointed. We should not despair and give up. No. With that discernment, it's not because of my weakness or others' faults. No. It's Satan stopping us. Then with that discernment, we can challenge at the right time, seeking God's leading. You see, Paul prayed. God made clear the way. And then, on the third mission journey, he went there, met them. As God allows Satan's work to the limit, there's a limit. Yes, God allows, but there's a limit. God uses Satan to accomplish his grand purpose in the end for his glory. One thing is written also in Daniel chapter 10. Daniel prayed for his people. Then a man in linen belt, linen clothes, and blazing iron said to Daniel, do not be afraid. Since the first day you set your mind to gain understanding and humble before God, your words are heard. I came in response to them. But the prince of the kingdom of Persia resisted me 21 days. But Michael, one of the archangels, came to help me because I was detained there with the king of Persia. The prince of the Persian kingdom, we know Satan is the prince of this world. It's a devil's hindrance. That's what's going on. That's one phenomenon of the spiritual world. As for Jesus, to suffer and die on the cross was God's will for him. But Satan hindered him, even through his top disciple, Peter. After making you are the Christ, then Jesus said about his way of suffering and death. Then Peter said, no, don't do that. He rebuked Jesus. Jesus said, you're Satan. Get away. Get behind me, Satan. You're a stumbling block to me. You do not have in mind the things of God, but things of man. And while Jesus was dying on the cross, all sorts of people said, come down from the cross. Save yourself and us. Just knew God's will to the end. As for us also, when we try to do the will of God, there are hindrances through close human relationships, any sort of people. But when you are sure that it's Satan's hindrance, then we should all the more challenge and pray, overcome any discouragement. Remember, Jesus said, in Matthew chapter 18. We're not talking about justice for his chosen ones. Will he put them off? Keep putting them up? I tell you, you'll see that he'll get justice. They'll get justice and quickly. Persistently. Lord, give me justice. Give me justice. Grant me justice. What is justice? Justice, God's kingdom. Greatest injustice is Satan's rule, Satan's kingdom. Justice, your kingdom, your rule. Third, when it comes, now Paul says, what is our hope, our joy, or the crown in which we glory in the presence of our Lord Jesus? It's not you, indeed. You are our glory and joy. Interestingly, after saying Satan stopped us, Paul did not help them to have anticipation of their coming. Rather, the Lord's coming. They are meeting the Lord. What a glorious day it will be, meeting the Lord. He wants them to have this expectation and living with Jesus forever without any separation. When the Lord Jesus comes, what will happen? The kingdom of this world will become kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ. He reigns with his people, his saints. And then there will be eternal kingdom of God in new heaven and new earth. So Revelation 21 says, now the dwelling of God is with man, and he lives with them. There will be his people, and he lives with them, and be their God. So just coming again, and kingdom of Christ in this world, and eternal kingdom of God are in one set. In light of this, yes, people want to accomplish many things in this world. It's good to study hard and work hard. But here, we need to think that when it comes again, what really matters? First of all, the soul salvation is most important. Salvation of my soul. So Jesus said, what can a man give? What good is it for a man to gain the whole world yet forfeit his soul? He said in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, what can a man give in exchange for his soul? Even the whole world cannot be an exchange for a soul, one soul. And also, we have to know that we cannot present before him our degree or our position, our wealth? No. And we find here something wonderful here. We find something wonderful here. We can present before him the souls, other souls who have been regenerated through us. That's what we can present. Again, we cannot present our family members, our close friends, if they are not regenerated. It'll be a time of eternal separation or living forever together in glory and joy. Can you imagine family members, parents and children are separated eternally? If they are not regenerated, that's why we should pray desperately for our family members and close ones, and those souls in our mission field, eternal separation or eternally living together at the moment. That's the reason Jesus, from the beginning, God's Son, preached the good news of the kingdom of God. The time has come. The kingdom of God is near. Repent and believe the good news. He traveled about from one town and village proclaiming the good news of God. He sent his disciples to preach the gospel. And even the last week, final week of his life, every day he went in the temple and taught. And people heard it. Even on the cross, he invited one repentant sinner to his kingdom. The sinner who said, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. I tell you the truth. Today you will be with me in paradise. And Apostle Paul said in 2 Timothy chapter 4, in the presence of God and view of our Lord Jesus who judged the living and the dead. And in the view of his coming and his kingdom, I'll give you this charge. Preach the word. In season, out of season. View of his coming and his kingdom, I give you this charge. Another time he said to Galatians, My dear children, in whom I am again in the pains of childbirth till Christ is formed in you. And he said to Corinthians, after saying about resurrection, therefore, my dear friends, stand firm, let nothing move you. Always give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. That means all the labor without, apart from Christ, in vain. But your Lord in Jesus will not be in vain. Here we see, for what we should investigate our lives. Jesus said in Luke chapter 16, I tell you, use worldly wealth to gain friends for yourselves, so that when it's gone, you'll be welcomed into eternal dwellings. Really, use all resources to save your souls. When I made it on this path, I'm repentant of poorness in saving souls. Mercy on me to know this. Only you can present before him souls who have been regenerated through me. Thank God for his unchanging love, his redeeming sacrificial love to his son's death for us. We may dwell in this love of God, this son Satan's attack, hindrance. Invest our lives for the saving of souls with whom we can stand before the Lord Jesus when he comes. Amen. Let's pray. Dear Father, thank you so much for your great love, which you demonstrate while we are still sinners. Christ died for us. In that way, you saved souls one by one. They say Satan's hindrance, but what a glorious day it will be. We can stand before the Lord Jesus, present before the Lord Jesus the souls who have been regenerated through us. Even all beloved ones, family members, stand before him with glory and joy. What a day it will be in the kingdom of Christ reigns, in the kingdom of God eternally live together. This is clear truth of God. Father, these are words of God. Father, please remember your people here to dwell in God's love in any changing situation, unchanging love of God. May hold fast his son Satan's hindrance. Truly invest our lives, saving our souls one by one, and stand before the Lord Jesus together. Thank you for your words. I pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.